Today we're talking about Venezuela, a country most famous for, well, looking like an Uzi. What can I say? They chose middle school to make us all learn geography. Guarantee you'll never not be able to find it on a map now, though. Venezuela is listed as a democracy, in the same way your homecoming king is a monarch. Their most recent election was called into question by almost everybody, because what do you know, the guy who controls the military won. Again. The re-elected leader and ambitious Saddam Hussein body double Nicolas Maduro, fingers crossed no foreshadowing there, was inaugurated 2 weeks ago.
The presidents of Bolivia, Cuba, El Salvador, and Nicaragua attended the swearing-in ceremony along with representatives from China, Mexico, and Turkey. But a long list of other countries made a point of being absent, saying they will not recognize Nicolas Maduro as the legitimate president of Venezuela.
And that's where we come to the crux of the issue, because the leader of the country's legislature, Juan Guaido, which in an American context would make him essentially Nancy Pelosi, recently said that the election was rigged, so Maduro shouldn't be president. And while that frees up a certain job he'd be very interested in taking. Days later, he swore himself in, and Speaker Pelosi, please don't get any ideas. Specifically, if there's no president, the Constitution of Venezuela assigns the person in his congressional leadership position to temporarily run the country. Generally, this would be the end of the conversation, but quite a few countries, including the United States and Canada, have stepped up and recognized him as the new leader, which is leading to all sorts of problems. For example, recently Maduro ordered that the United States pull our diplomats from Venezuela. And in response, the United States says, "What? I didn't hear anything, do you?" It's almost like someone who incorrectly thinks they're the president is trying to talk to us. We're only going to take orders from the other guy who we think is president. It's not like nobody supports Maduro either, with heavy hitters like Russia and China consistently coming in to aid the leader with loans and favorable petroleum purchases. So the international community is pretty split right now, but there's one other incredibly important constituency that both presidents are trying to lobby.
Supreme Court judges have pledged their unwavering support, with the country's powerful military also vowing to remain loyal to the Venezuelan leader.
No Supreme Court support? Well, that constitutional angle just got a lot harder. Also, with the military pledging to support the established government, it's a pretty large obstacle. Although, it wasn't a unanimous decision.
Venezuela says it has arrested 27 members of the country's National Guard accused of launching an uprising against the government of President Nicolas Maduro.
Yeah, you bet top brass shut that down pretty quick though. So now we have a feel for what's going on. Let's get to the question on everybody's mind. What next? A small oil-rich country is actually looking to be democratized? You won't have to ask John Bolton twice. We're already doing a few tricky moves to try and shift the balance of power in the region. Before you watch this next clip, the National Assembly is Venezuela's Congress, which is led by Guaido.
President Trump's endorsement allows the U.S. to redirect payments for Venezuelan oil, which accounts for 90% of Venezuela's GDP.
Every single asset, every single bank account, every single contract, all the management and of these republic's asset will be transferred to the National Assembly and to Juan Guaido's.
Jeez, that is a glaring weakness. Their country has the economic complexity of an M&M store. So, it's three stories of checkout line chocolates? Well, I think we have a t-shirt around here somewhere. Crude and refined petroleum alone make up over 80% of their exports. And of that, 34% or over one-third of their exports go to the United States. So, if we start paying the person we recognize as president instead of the guy who is currently president, that would really throw a wrench in the system, because they'd stop getting paid for one-third of their exports. Legally, it would be a little bit trickier though, because, well, I know Venezuela is considered to be a corrupt country, but even their presidents don't take personal checks on oil sales. So, we can't just direct deposit oil money into this guy's account. We can't pay Congress either, or that would just defeat the whole purpose. Instead, we're going to be putting our oil payments into an escrow account until the country sorts this all out. At the same time, America successfully lobbied the Bank of England not to give Maduro access to Venezuela's $1.2 billion in gold reserves. Because, oh geez, according to our country's documents, you aren't the president of Venezuela. So Western countries, for the most part, are trying to keep as much money as possible out of Venezuela.
What we're focusing on today is disconnecting the illegitimate Maduro regime from the sources of its revenues. We think consistent with our recognition of Juan Guaido as the constitutional interim president of Venezuela.
Well, we're certainly not being subtle with our plans. As you can imagine, not everybody's down with the down with Maduro chants. And there's some people with deep pockets trying to keep this country stable.
China, Turkey, and Syria, meanwhile, have all joined Russia in expressing their support for President Maduro.
Russia and China have spent a fair amount of money propping up the Maduro government for over a decade. And bang up job, you guys, that country is just a paradise right now. If there's a shortage of money, critics think Maduro can either get loans from them or potentially take out some of his gold reserves in Turkey. During all of this commotion, there's another side that's not getting as much attention. Having the United States back you in a Venezuelan election isn't exactly a ringing endorsement some people here would imagine it would be. In a devastatingly sick burn, Russia's foreign minister recently said, "The United States is once again trying to decide the fate of another country. You don't even need to set up a Mueller investigation here." Oh, yeah, we're definitely tinkering with this democratic process, really publicly. With the difference being that this process has already been so rigged that us going under the hood will set it all right. Oh, and it just so happens that the guy we're setting it right for will probably vote with us rather than other people. This is definitely the angle Maduro is taking.
No se fíen.
Do not trust the gringo empire. The gringos do not have friends, nor are they loyal to anyone. The gringos have interests. Venezuelan oil, Venezuelan gas, Venezuelan gold. But to that empire we say, that oil, that gas, that gold is not yours.
What? Gringos? Not us!
Hola. I'm Mike Pence, the Vice President of the United States. On behalf of the American people, we say to all the good people of Venezuela, estamos con ustedes.
Oh god, we're gringos. Yeah, we have to pretend that Donald J. Trump and Mike Pence give even the smallest of hoots to make this not a blatant case of interference. America first, build a wall. What? You're telling me a medium-sized socialist Latin American country has people fighting for their rights? Who cares? Wait, it's the country shaped like an Uzi? Well, get my foreign policy advisor on the phone right now. In the end, though, everybody's focus is on one group, the Venezuelan military. Now, I know I said earlier on that Venezuelan leaders are standing by Maduro, and they are. But there's a difference between the leadership and the guys on the ground, specifically regarding limiting access to food, water, power, and medicine, leading some of them to start splintering off.
I don't think Maduro has the military. He has statements by his Minister of Defense, who owes his job to Maduro. I think the average service member is very much on the side of Juan Guaido, the interim president. I think the military is still up in the air.
Now that was John Bolton himself, a man with quite the agenda, so take that with a grain of salt. I chose that clip because people are focusing on driving a wedge between the top brass and the men they command. Overall in Venezuela, it seems like the US isn't going all in though, but rather our primary strategy is not paying for things and ignoring their leader. The US doesn't really have a ton to lose here either, as we've bagged several coups against the regime in the early 2000s, so they're already not the biggest fans of ours. The main thing it feels like we're doing is sitting on the sidelines and just doing as much as possible without risking anything to destabilize this government. We're not really a fan of. It's pretty widely accepted that we're not going to invade the country either, and we probably won't sell rebels or weapons because they're a hop, skip, and a jump away from our border. America's stated goal is to drain Venezuela of resources to the point where they can't afford to pay their soldiers.
Today here in Washington, we've been looking at ways to disconnect Maduro from the financial resources he needs to pay the military and otherwise keep himself in power.
Government not being able to pay federal workers. I could see how that would make a leader unpopular. Can't imagine what that would look like. Yeah, we've got a pretty good case study on how this messes up everything. So we'll see if we can hurt their economy to the point where their troops defect. Either way, their leadership can't hate us much more than they already do. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.